You're alive and living well in me.
Amen. If you have your Bibles this morning, I would encourage you to turn to John chapter number 2. John chapter number 2. As we have been engaged in a series of messages that I've simply entitled The Master of Miracles, over the last few weeks we have encountered the man with a withered hand who had his hand fully restored by the Lord. We have examined the passage that where we met the maniac in the garden, the maniac who had been tormented, and at last he found peace. And then most recently we found our master feeding the multitudes, and we learned the lesson, food for life, faith for living. Whether it's a man with a withered hand, whether there's a maniac in the house this morning, or whether the master just needs to feed us, I'm thankful that if we will open our hearts and we have faith, there's nothing impossible with God. Say amen. Do you believe that? And Jesus' miracles always had a purpose. The miracle before us today resulted in the manifestation of His glory, and it showed His disciples belief in Him as a result of this miracle. This is the first of Jesus' public miracles. I want you to notice that this miracle, as we study it, we're going to find that it was not performed in a temple, but it was performed in a Jewish home. It was not performed at a funeral home, but it was performed at a wedding, a joyous place, a joyous occasion. It was not performed during a fast, but it was performed during a time of feasting. And I believe it serves as a reminder that the life of a Christian should reflect the joy that characterized the life of Jesus. Even though Jesus knew what His purpose was, even though Jesus knew what lie ahead of Him, Jesus encouraged joy in individuals. Jesus brought joy to individuals. In John chapter number 15, later, John relays the message. Jesus reminded His disciples of His love for them, saying that its purpose was that His joy, the joy of the Lord, remain in them, and that their joy may be full. That's my prayer for us this morning, that our joy in the Lord may be full. Paul reminds us in Galatians chapter number 5 that one of the fruits of the Spirit is joy. I remember David, in writing one of the Psalms, said, "In Your presence, Lord, is the fullness of joy." And so I believe that this illustrates a joy that should characterize every Christian life. And my Lord, have mercy on me as I look out at You this morning. You could use some joy. My goodness, y'all scare me to death this morning. Come on. All right, that's better. John chapter 2, verse number 1. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Now both Jesus and His disciples were invited to the wedding. And when they ran out of wine, the mother of Jesus said to Him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to His mother, "Woman, what does your concern have to do with Me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Whatever He says to you, do it." Now there sat there 6 water pots of stone, according to the manner of purification of the Jews, containing 20 or 30 gallons apiece. And Jesus said to them, "Fill the water pots with water." And they filled them up to the brim. And He said to them, "Draw some out now and take it to the master of the feast." And they took it. And when the master, or when the head waiter of the feast, the governor of the feast, had tasted the water that was made wine and did not know where it came from, but the servants who had drawn the water knew. The master of the feast called the bridegroom, and he said to him, "Every man at the beginning sets out the good wine, and when the guests have well drunk, then the inferior. You have kept the good wine until now." This beginning of signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for the opportunity, Lord Jesus, just to be able to read your precious word, to study the words that you have preserved for so many centuries. I pray this morning for your anointing as always. I pray that you would help me, Lord Jesus, in sincerity and simplicity. Lord, as you would guide my thoughts, guide my words, I pray that you would help me share these thoughts that we may be encouraged in you this morning. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen and amen. Again, this miracle was really the beginning of the public ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ. In verse number 1, we find that it is telling us about a wedding, the details of the wedding. It says that it was the third day, probably meaning that it was the third day after he had his encounter in the previous chapter with Nathanael. And so it appears that 3 days later, Jesus and his disciples find themselves in Cana. Cana of Galilee. It was a village west of the Sea of Galilee. It was a short distance from Capernaum. I think it's interesting that it's mentioned only in John's Gospel and only on 3 occasions. And so here they are in Cana, and they have been invited to this wedding. And we see, as Mary speaks up in the way that she does, that Mary was there in some sort of important capacity. We'll look further into that. First of all, I want us to look just briefly at the guests at the wedding in verses number 1 and verses number 2. Again, we see that Jesus and his disciples had been invited. May I pause here and say that Jesus wants to be invited to every vital part of our lives. Jesus wants to be invited to be a very vital part of every aspect of our relationship with him, as we studied last week. Here we find that he has been invited at the beginning of the wedding ceremony. I believe that a marriage ought to include the inviting of the Lord Jesus into the midst. Amen. I sincerely believe that with all of my heart. I believe that as a marriage, that is founded on Christ, that Christ as a foundation will strengthen that marriage. I believe that when Christ is a foundation of that marriage, and that marriage is built on the type of love that he showed unto the church, and that he showed unto the world, I believe that when that type of love is exchanged among those who are married, that it sets a direction that is a positive direction. And I believe that's the kind of marriage that we need in the world today. I thank God for the lady I'm married with. I want to be a better husband. Hopefully she wants to be a better wife. And from time to time we make changes so that that can occur. Amen. Marriage is a give and take situation. I believe with all of my heart that when God is invited into the midst and when he is included in every decision, then I believe that a marriage can be strong in God, and the devil will not be able to disrupt that when both the husband and the wife are at union with God and are at union with one another. Glory to God, marriage can be what God intended it to be until death do you part. Somebody say amen. Now there are some things that we don't know about the wedding. We really don't know who was getting married. We have no indication about who it was that was getting married. We don't know any details about them. Why, they're not even really hardly mentioned at all, rather than the bridegroom. So we don't know a lot about them, but I would imagine as two people unite in marriage, I can imagine that there was much anticipation that was brought into this marriage. I believe that the groom anticipated that his bride would be his soulmate for life. I believe that he anticipated that she would be his helpmeet as God had intended. And I believe that she anticipated that her husband would be the provider, that her husband would offer leadership. And I believe that they anticipated that together they could overcome any odds. Amen. I believe that they had an appreciation before one another. I believe that when you are truly in love and when you find that soul, and you find that one that God has called you to be with, then I believe that there will not only be anticipation of that union, but there will be an appreciation for the one that you are going to be united with. Amen. I appreciate my wife. I appreciate that she tolerated me in the early days, and I appreciate that she looked after me and kept me out of trouble in the early days, and even so today. And so I appreciate my wife. I was watching early this morning ESPN, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. got married December the 31st this last year, and they had a wedding celebration that went all night, and they celebrated into the new year. And so they were interviewing the two of them, and they were asking her about him and him about her. And one of the things that Dale Jr. said was, "I appreciate the way that she has helped me see the proper perspective in life outside of racing." Amen. Yeah, I mean, I appreciate the things that my wife has helped me to see and has helped me to understand. So I believe that though we don't know much details about the wedding, I believe it was met with much anticipation. I believe it was met with much appreciation. And I believe it was a sign of an affirmation of a commitment that they had for better or for worse. Amen. And I believe that's how marriage should be entered. But moving from that, there was speculation concerning the marriage, I guess. It's probably some relative of Mary, perhaps of Joseph. Joseph may not have been in the picture at this time. He may have gone on to paradise. But it certainly seems that it could have been one of Mary's relatives, seeing that Mary's prominence indicates that it could have been a family wedding, because she spoke up. She saw a problem and she was ready to take care of the problem. Amen. I am thankful for meddling mother-in-laws that want to take care of problems in the lives of their son and daughters, as long as they don't cross the line. Yeah. I mean, I'm sure that Raylene has appreciated her in-law's input into their marriage from time to time. Maybe somewhere along the line, Lonnie and Connie's helped Wesley a little bit with some advice, though. I don't know. I think that it is important for us as parents to encourage our children. And I believe that we need to have an open door policy, that we are willing to allow our children to come. And they need to know that they can come to us if there's any problems that they are facing individually or collectively as a married couple or a family. Amen. Mary's prominence really does indicate that it was probably a family wedding. And I want us to see also in verses 1 and 2 how closely Jesus is associated with his disciples. An invitation to Jesus always included his disciples. Once he called his disciples, you see them going many places. Others should know that Jesus goes where we go. Amen. And we need to know that as Christians, Jesus goes where we go. And while we might try to exclude him from what we're doing, he is there with us by way of his Holy Spirit. So maybe we need to check out and just make sure that we're keeping good company. Amen. The guests at the wedding. But let's see the good advice that was given at the wedding in verses 3 through 5. A problem arises. Obviously, they run out of wine. Weddings, I have found, are a great place for problems. How many of you have discovered that weddings are a great place for problems to occur? Huh? You forgot a corsage. You forgot a headband. You're worried about somebody running late. The minister forgot where the wedding was at. That's never happened to me. The minister forgot what time the wedding was. That's never happened to me either. You know why? Because Karen's always kept me in line. Amen. I mean, listen. We've had some folks beautifully walk down the steps. I have stood here and prayed, Lord, don't let them fall down them steps. Lord, don't let them fall down them steps. Amen. I have prayed and said, Lord, don't let them flower children get too wild. Honestly, Lord, rehearsal was a disaster. I pray that you keep these kids in line, Lord Jesus. But whatever happens, happens. Amen. And we just overcome and we just go right on to the important part. Amen. Problems seem to find their way into everything that we do. Amen. And we're all faced with problems. We cannot escape problems. It doesn't matter what we're doing. And so on this most joyous of days, when everything has been planned and every detail has been considered, a problem arises. They're out of wine. And Mary handles the problem. She takes the problem to Jesus. It was her first thought. When she saw there was a problem, her first thought was, my son, Jesus, can take care of this problem. Amen. How many times do we face problems and Jesus is not the first thought in our mind? Huh? How many times does something go awry or something go wrong and the first thing we think is, how am I going to get out of this mess? I'm guilty. How am I going to fix this problem? Without giving a thought to saying, Lord, I know that you can help me and thank you, Lord God, for what you're going to help me do. Amen. Or what you're going to help me see, or what you're going to help me learn, or what you're going to help me say. Amen. The Lord should always be our first thought when a problem arises. It don't matter how small or it don't matter how big that it is. When you rise up in the morning, you ought to be giving thanks to God that you're breathing air. When you rise up in the morning, before you ever get out of bed, you need to commit yourself to the Lord that day and say, God, this is going to be a day that you have given me, and Lord, whatever comes my way, I want to act in a way that will bring glory to your name. And I, Lord Jesus, want to be a testimony, God, that stands unreproved before the world for your glory. And if you'll start your day that way, you can face your problems that way whenever they arise. I'm telling you. A good example for us, when problems come, take them to Jesus. And Jesus says, woman, what does your concern have to do with me? For my hour has not yet come. And I've told you before, I'm sure I preached this text. If you'll remember, when Jesus hung on the cross, he looked down at John and he said, "Woman," and he said to Mary, "Woman, behold thy son." And to John he said, "Behold thy mother." Woman was a verbiage of respect. It was not meant to demean Mary, but Jesus was trying to refocus her perspective and remind her of his purpose. Hear me closely and don't overlook this. He is saying, this is really not a problem. Why do you want to bother me with this? Maybe there wasn't proper preparation. Maybe there wasn't proper planning. Maybe too many people showed up. I don't know. But Jesus says, remember why I have come. And he was just helping her regain her perspective. Let's don't be too hard on Mary. As Jesus was growing up, she knew absolutely that he was the Son of God. I cannot imagine the challenges that may have come with the knowledge of raising Jesus. I can't imagine how she would raise Jesus, and I can't imagine what Jesus may have been like. I can't imagine how he must have talked to his mother, the things he could have shown her. I can't imagine that relationship, because the Bible doesn't tell us much about that. Now, does it? But Mary gave some good advice. She said, whatsoever he says unto you, do it. She took for granted, though, that though Jesus said what he said, that he was going to honor her because he was, after all, her son. Children, honor your father and your mother. I get very cynical in life because I work in the public eye and I see how disrespectful some children are towards their parents. But then when I hear their parents speak to their children, I think to myself, they are acting just like the example that you are showing them. Hear me now. And then I have a couple of sweet blondes come in yesterday as I was just about to get out of work. Nice, well-behaved, polite. Really, they're always nice to me. I don't know. And I always hug their neck. Your kids are going to mimic what you do. And it doesn't matter how old you are as a parent. And it doesn't matter how old your children are. You listen to me carefully. They will imitate you. And your habits will be their habits. Your language will be often their language. And you need to have some respect for mom and daddy. But mom and daddy, you need to have enough respect for your kids to raise them in the right way. And grandparents, you need to have enough respect for your children not to let them get by with just anything they want to, but help them find the meaning of discipline in their life. Man, that's good preaching. It's not very shoutful today, but that's good preaching. And we should always be ready to do whatever Jesus wants us to do. Somebody say amen. Because what Jesus tells people to do will always be in accordance with his word. What Jesus tells people to do will always involve where we are at the time we are there. It will always involve using something at hand. You can see that in verse number 6. It will always involve labor. If God asks us to do something, it's going to require something of us. Verse number 7. It'll also involve faith. Verse number 7. But it will demonstrate faith to others. And you can see that in verse number 8. I want you to know that great things happen when we obey Jesus. Amen. I remember my mom giving me advice when I visited the neighbors around my neighborhood. Whatever their mom or dad, let's say I was visiting, I don't know, but Emmy Lou's kids. Whatever Emmy Lou tells you to do while you're there at her house, you do it. Amen? And it was sort of like an unwritten policy. If somebody came to my house, I knew that they had been given the instructions, whatever Polly tells you to do, you better do it. Amen. I think that we need to be in this all together. Amen. I can remember my dad's advice when I went to my first job. He says, whatever he tells you to do, just do it. And don't complain about it. And eventually, you'll make a good impression and you'll get to do something else. And I can't believe that all these years later, I'm doing the same thing I started out doing. Amen. It's a full circle. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In the water pots, Jesus says, hey, look at these water pots. Water pots of stone. Customarily, they were used for different things. There was water pots that sat by the doors, and when visitors came, they would take their sandals off, and you as the host would kneel down with a cloth, you would dip it in the water pot, and you would wash the dust off their feet, and that was your greeting to them. Water pots were used for folks, whenever they came in, before they ate, to dip their hands into the water and ceremoniously wash their hands, clean them up. Utensils. Ceremoniously, you would wash your utensils before you begin your dinner. So there were a lot to do with water pots and customs of the day. But you see how many are mentioned here. And basically, it was a capacity of somewhere close to 180 gallons of water that Jesus turned to wine. I don't know how many people were there. And I don't know how much you like grape juice. But son, I'm telling you, 180 gallons of grape juice will last me for a long time. And y'all forgive me if you think this is wrong. But I buy my grape juice at a winery. So if you see me come out of the winery with a case, it is Concord grape juice, and it is absolutely the best stuff I've ever drank. I send it to people all over the United States. Amen. I love me some grape juice. I was talking to somebody yesterday. I said, how are you on juice? He said, I'm drinking that nasty old Welch's, and he called something out. I said, don't worry, I'll have you fixed up by the end of the week, amen? 180 gallons of juice, that must have been a mighty big party, amen? Huh? The good wine of the wedding is mentioned, verses 9, verses number 10. Jesus performs his miracle, and at the first taste, the head waiter, the caterer, the main caterer, the governor, he knew there was something special about this. He could taste the difference. You kept the good wine until now. There's some lessons in the miracle of this wine. Only Jesus keeps the best until last. Jesus keeps the best until last. I have enjoyed most of my 50 plus years of life. I've had some ups, I've had some downs. Some days I feel great, some days I feel lousy. But I'm thankful for every day I get up out of bed, amen. And you probably are too. The best day of my life here on this earth will not even begin to compare to what heaven is going to be like. Amen? Because when we go through life with all of its struggles and with all of its trials, with all of its temptations, with all of its joys, with all of its gifts, with all of its blessings, we know that the best is yet to come. Amen? For believers, we know that eternity is awaiting for us, and every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Amen. Whatever Jesus recreates, in the case of this miracle, water, is better than it was, and it's better than man could ever make it. Jesus performs his first miracle not merely to replenish the wine supply, but I believe also to save a humble Gentile family from disgrace and embarrassment. You see, running out of food or wine at a wedding feast was considered a terrible thing, socially speaking, on the part of the groom's family. It'd be horrible. Church, we need to remember that we are called the bride of Christ in the Bible repeatedly. Amen? So let us rest assured that our groom, our Savior, the Master of Miracles, will never embarrass us if we walk in His will. Amen. Our Master, the Master of the Miracles, will never embarrass us if we walk in His will. He will embrace us, and good things will happen in our life. And today can be better than yesterday, and tomorrow can be better than today. And the provision that He has for us is endless. So blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. Jesus' miracle. His miracles always had a purpose. The miracle that we've studied this morning again resulted in the manifestation of His glory. For everyone saw. The servants saw the power of Jesus. Those that were commanded to fill the water pots with water, they saw the glory of God in action. And His disciples, seeing what He did, had their faith increased to an unbelievable, unimaginable level. God's done something for you somewhere in your life. Whether you realize it or not, I'm sure He's performed a miracle or miracles, plural, in your life. If you have children, you have seen a miracle that God has given you. Some of you have been healed when you were sick. Some of you have had money come from nowhere when you were broke. Some of you, when you were at your rock bottom lowest, has had some stranger come to you and in some act of kindness change your day. God is a master of miracles. And however He chooses to manifest Himself, I want to be a willing, waiting, ready participant. God be glorified through me, a sinner saved by grace. God's not willing that any should perish, but that all should have everlasting life. Jesus offers us the water of life. Jesus offers us the wine of joy, if you will. Rejoice. And again, Paul says, rejoice always in the Lord. Ain't God good? Give the Lord a hand this morning. Maybe this morning you need a touch from the Master. Maybe you need something restored in your life. Maybe like the maniac at the garden, you're searching for peace. Maybe as the multitudes who were hungry, you hunger for something from God. Or maybe like this instance, there's a problem in your life. Jesus can solve that problem. If only you'll come to Him. And if you'll trust and confide in Him, He can make a difference today and tomorrow. and for ages and ages to come.